for Bobby Cox, and there is one noticeable change. Batting third will be Tony Tarasco this afternoon. It's Tony's first start since April 17th at Chicago. And we'll see how he fares today in his first assignment in some time. Everything else remains the same with Kent Merker, the pitcher, batting ninth. The defense for the Rockies, the same as last night. Eric Young in left, Chris Jones in center, Dante Bichette in right. On the infield, Hayes, Weiss, Liriano, and Galarraga. Joe Girardi behind the plate, and on the mound, 30-year-old Greg Harris. He is 2-2, an ERA of 5.20 in his this year. He has left with the lead, and the bullpen could not hold the lead for him. Last year, split time between San Diego and Colorado and allowed 33 home runs, which was tops in the National League. This year, his ERA a little better in May, but the results pretty much the same, 1-1 in each month thus far. Lifetime against Atlanta, 3-3. Umpires for today's ball game, and this is significant, with Rich Ryker behind the plate, Davidson, Davis, and Hahn around first, second, and third. But Ryker was behind the plate in Cincinnati for game one of that series on the road trip, where the Braves lost to the Reds by a score of 4-3 in 10 innings. And you may recall that there was a close play at the plate to end the ball game. Kevin Mitchell scoring on a sacrifice fly got a lot of heat from Bobby Cox and other Braves, but their argument was more about some balls and strikes calls that Ryker was seemed to be a little inconsistent with. We'll see if he does a little better job today, at least in the eyes of the Atlanta Braves. But a great day for baseball. Temperatures expected to be in the high 70s. The wind blowing in a little bit, which is different from last night, so maybe a little difficult for left-handed batters to hit the ball out to right field.
And in the other baseball, quickly, Joe, after an inning, the Cubs lead the Giants 5-2. Brian Hickerson against Frank Castillo. Detroit 3-2 over Milwaukee after 4.5. Mulvaughn has a home run in that game. And the Yankees lead Baltimore 5-2 after 2.5. Bob Melvin has homered in that one. Toronto hammering Cleveland 8-1 at the end of 3. All the other action is later this afternoon, or it will be played tonight. And Deion Sanders ready to lead things off. Sanders hitting at 283 with 4 homers, 18 RBIs, 16 out of 22 in the stolen base department. A lot of empty seats here. And those are people who have either gone to McNichols Arena or have stayed home to watch the Nuggets play the Jazz and switch back and forth and watch the Rockies game as well. But all those tickets are sold, so we'll doubtless get an announcement of a crowd of better than 70,000. Deion 1-for-4 last night. He's in a 3-for-24 slump that has gotten his average to 283, and that's about as low as it's been all year long. They play him as a dead pull hitter. The pitch outside, and we're underway. Greg Harris, 30-year-old right-hander, makes his home in Las Vegas now. He's from Greensboro, North Carolina. 6'2", 190-pounder. Line drive, base hit, a good start for Atlanta. And Deion appears to be back on the track. Wide turn at first, but he scrambles back. And he's aboard with nobody out. Harris in 55 and a third innings this year. Now has given up 52 hits, 33 runs, only one of them unearned. 26 walks, 35 strikeouts, 5 home run balls. And coming into this game, the league hitting 249 against it.
He relies on finesse. He's got to hit corners. He's not going to overpower anybody. Has a good curveball. We'll see how much it breaks in this altitude.
Jeff Blauser is the batter. And that's low and away. One ball, no strikes. Blauser 6 out of 23 in his career against Greg Harris, a home run included. He was 2-for-5 last night, drove in a run, scored one. Grass here is in rough shape, isn't it?
It's a little chewed up, especially on the infield.
Deion, a good size lead at first. They throw over there, he's back easily. They really watered it down here before the game, but they have to do that here because the wind blows. There are gusts between 12 and 18 miles an hour expected throughout the game today. Close, but he's back. Runner at first, nobody out.
Harris's last start against the Dodgers on the 16th, not a good one. He only went 4 2/3 innings, gave up 10 hits. But prior to that, his four starts before that, he had pitched into the seventh inning or better.
Again, Dion Beck, you mentioned before Harris started last year with San Diego. What do you say to your fans if you're in the front office of that San Diego Padre team and in the middle of May, you're 8 games behind the expansion Rockies and 12 games behind the expansion Florida Marlins? First, again, the runner back.
Some information that I read in a report last week about that clearing of the salaries last year, where they really dismissed a lot of guys, traded a lot of guys. They made several million dollars. Maybe that's why, but they also were saying that they couldn't afford those people, yet made quite a bit of money.
Into the dirt. Good play, Girardi. Two balls, no strikes.
Answer to your question is, I don't know what to tell him. The guy I feel for is Jim Riggleman, the manager.
He's managing with his hands handcuffed behind him. Two balls, no strikes.
Should have been a balk. Had his foot on the rubber, picked up his left foot to knock dirt out of it, and I can't believe Balk-a-day Bob Davidson didn't see it.
Well, he should be ashamed of himself. He will be sick if he ever finds out that he missed one that was actually a balk. Maybe that's his deal. He doesn't call them when they're really what. The 2-0 pitch. Again to first. We may be here a while this afternoon the way this is starting out.
Be a good one to run on here. I think Dion was moving anyway. Look at the size of his lead. That's what's drawing Harris's attention. But threw it low, and let's see if he's willing to go over there again. It's about as big a lead as I can remember Dion getting on any pitcher.
He's going. Check swing, foul tip. Two balls and a strike to count. Two and one the count. Sanders returns to first, and as he does, he checks out Jimmy Williams. I bet we get another throw to first now.
He has to get a good lead and a good jump. His jump was not particularly good on that last pitch because Girardi has a real good arm behind the plate. 8 of his last 13 he's gunned down.
Two balls and a strike. Bluffs the runner back. He is sick, and the ball pops away from Galarraga. Two balls and a strike. The curveball is Harris's best pitch. Unless it's his move to first. Runner goes outside. Girardi can't find it. Dion around second. He'll make third easily. It'll be a stolen base and a wild pitch, and the runner is at third with nobody out. Stolen base gets him to second. That's his 17th in 23 tries. Wild pitch gets him to third.
Watch how Girardi went after this ball, too. He tried to backhand it, knowing Dion was running. Normally, you'll see Girardi shift his weight out there and make sure the ball doesn't get by him. But with the runner moving, he wanted to throw him out. And it cost him an extra base as a result.
And the count goes to 3-1 on Blauser. Infield back, except for Hayes at third base. Inside, I guess. Harris shakes his head in disbelief. Boy, that looks like a pretty good hit. Runners at first and third. Nobody out in the Braves. With a chance for a big first inning, here's Tony Tarasco.
The one thing about this ballpark, Skip, and I think very important for Kent Merker today, is that because the way it flies out of here, you just can't afford to walk batters and put them on base. It really leads to big innings.
Well, you saw the home run Dave Gallagher hit last night. He made a good pitch on him. He didn't have a good swing, and we're not knocking him. He hit a home run, but that can happen here. Outside, one ball, no strikes. Girardi to the mound to talk to Harris. Braves have it going early here in Mile High Stadium. The weather is absolutely gorgeous, about 75 degrees, a bright sun shining, some white puffy cumulus clouds off in the distance.
Oh, Willard Carey again, back
there
at
we
it.
Go, there you go. The stretch. Swung, hot shot, might be a double play. Good play there. He is out there, and a runner's in. Weiss left the ball beautifully for Liriano, and he made a good pivot. No RBI for Tarasco, but the Braves lead.
Nice backhanded flip, and this is tough on Nelson Liriano, who's got to turn 180 degrees and make a good throw to Galarraga and get a fast runner, and they did it.
Fred McGriff is the batter. McGriff, 12 homers, 28 RBIs, a 306 average. He's never batted against Greg Harris, probably because they were teammates in San Diego. McGriff at 306. 12 homers, 28 runs batted in.
He's having a good laugh about something with Girardi.
Low and inside, one ball, no strikes. What a cut he had, but he fouled it off. We keep talking about all the people filing into McNichols Arena. Only trouble is there's nobody filing into McNichols Arena. We can see it off in the distance. Well, there go two people.
They're in now. Look how far Rich Ryker is behind the catcher as the pitch is being delivered. All umpires have their own styles, but I don't know that I've ever seen an umpire stand that far behind the catcher and then move in from that distance to make a call.
Could be that Girardi, after the game last night, had a dinner of sausage and peppers and that moved the umpire back a foot or two.
Hadn't thought of that.
Joe Garagiola used to say that all the time about Frank Dascoli. So that's what. Last thing you needed was him working a game of a doubleheader in hot weather after all the garlic. 3-2, 3-1 is the count to McGriff. The 3-1 pitch. Chopped it foul. Pat Corrales goes for it, makes the play. Nice going, Pat. And he did a good job. He spotted a fellow with his youngster and got them the ball. The payoff pitch about to be made. Foul back and out of play.
Threw him a 3-2 breaking ball.
Yeah, the breaking ball is what's gotten him to the major leagues and kept him here.
His curveball is not as good as Eric Hansen's from Cincinnati that we saw a couple of days ago, but they're similar in their styles.
Outside, he walked him, so McGriff is aboard and Justice the banner. That's two walks in the inning.
Harris last year with San Diego was 10-9, a 3.67 ERA. After he came to Colorado, his record 1-8, 6.5 ERA.
I'll tell you what, I really think that all this talk, and it's true about how the ball flies out of here, psych some guys out. They just guys like our partner Don Sutton and Robin Roberts and so many other successful pitchers. Never worried much about the home runs. Go after the hitter. The solo home run's not going to beat you many games.
Right.
One of those two or three run shots or the double with the bases loaded. That's what does you harm. There's a breaking ball on the outside corner.
Well, I think it goes back to what I said a minute ago about no base on balls. You suddenly find yourself trying to be careful to avoid a solo homer. And before you know it, you've given up two walks and then you give up a homer.
This guy even gave up a run on a double play, for example. David a little bit off stride on that ball. He's hasn't been in a slump at all. But since May 3rd, nearly 3 weeks ago, he has just two RBIs.
Part of that, too, I think you have to say that he hasn't had a whole lot of runners on in front of him either.
Yeah, McGriff has taken care of a bunch of them.
Mm-hmm. Dion and Terry haven't been getting on that much in front of him either.
Curve, little squibber to short. Weiss has it to first, and the inning is over. The Braves get a run on a hit. There were no errors, a costly wild pitch, and one runner was left. We go to the bottom half of the first inning. Braves won, Rockies come to bat.
Braves jump on top first. They get a run in the first inning of play. We go to the Colorado half of the first inning. Take a look at Don Baylor's lineup this afternoon. It's pretty much the same as last night. The individuals are the same. The only switch would be Charlie Hayes batting fifth. Chris Jones will bat sixth. They just flip-flop in the order. Greg Harris, the pitcher, will bat ninth. For the Braves defensively, the one change, of course, in left field, Tony Tarasco. Everything else is the same with Javier Lopez behind the plate and Kent Merker on the mound. He's 2-0, an ERA of 3.90. Last year against the Rockies, 1-0, and he only pitched one inning against them.
While Weiss leads it off and takes a strike, it's 0-1.
And the thing about Kent Merker, few and far between are his starts of late. 11 days since his last start.
And that's the way to go after him. 0-2.
And only one start in 24 days.
Boy, that didn't miss by much. 1-2. The orders for Merker are pretty simple. To go as hard as you can, as long as you can, and we'll hope the bullpen can finish up for you. Line, but way foul. Got around late.
That brings up a good point. I was talking to Bobby Cox before the game about Steve Avery and why Steve only went 8 innings last night. He said he got tired. He said even though he pitched a strong eighth, he just got tired, and this altitude took its toll on him, as it did Jeff Blauser when he hit his double. He was over on his knees gasping for a little air after his double.
Sharply hit on one hop to the aforementioned Blauser. One away. Weiss is retired. Houston is just seconds away from eliminating Phoenix from NBA play. They lead them 101-94 in game 7, 23 seconds left. Eric Young, the batter, 0 for 4 last night. He's down to 196. This guy, a 270 hitter last year with 42 stolen bases. He has 4 stolen bases this year, but you can't steal first. This is the Braves' 40th game. We are virtually a quarter of the way home in regular season play. Steve Rank on the corner, 0-1.
On Preakness Day, we like to refer to that as a quarter pole.
The quarter pole, yes.
Good breaking ball.
And he's ahead of another hitter, 0-2. Dante Bichette waits to hit next. That's downstairs, a ball and 2 strikes.
I heard a good line today from Dwight Evans, the new hitting coach for the Rockies. I asked him if he was enjoying himself. He had a great comeback.
Line right at Pendleton, 2-0. An off-speed pitch. He sort of telegraphed it, but got a break. It was hit right at him. 2 down.
Evans said it's a little tough. He said instead of going 0 for 4, some nights I'm 0 for 30.
And the I know the frustrating part for a guy who's used to playing is that helpless feeling. There's nothing you can do about it once the guy stands in there. Bichette is hitting 294. He was 1 for 4 last night. He dropped a double down the right field line. Let up outside, 1 ball, no strikes. Looks like they have goats come in and feed on this grass here. Between games, it looks sort of scruffy.
Might be Dinger that's grazing out there a little
Could
bit.
Could be the Triceratops. 2-0. Dinger suffered a career-threatening injury just prior to the game when he was hit by an errant throw that may not have been that errant out of the Atlanta dugout. High drive, deep center field. Dion going back. He's got it, and the inning is over. The wind held that baby up a little bit. It didn't carry like it normally does here. 1-2-3, nothing doing in the first for the Rockies after an inning. 1-0 Atlanta. We go to the second inning. In the distance there, you see the ballpark into which the Rockies will move next year. Coors Field coming along very nicely.
Exterior of it reminds me in the drawings that they have in the media guide of Ebbets Field.
Boy, that would be great if they could get one like that. They started out planning on building a ballpark with 38,000 seats, but the unbelievable response they've had in this place, plans now call for 50,000, and I bet they wish they had more. Terry Pendleton hits a fly ball into right field. One pitch, one out. Javi Lopez, the batter. I just can't tell you how bad Pendleton's going anymore. I'm tired of bringing it up.
Think how he feels.
Oh, I know. That's what I mean. I just, even though all you're doing is telling the truth, it's like you're kicking him. A little bit outside the Atlanta catcher. He homered here last night. Lopez at 293.
We were talking about Terry's balance falling away from the plate last night. Watch Lopez, how he falls across the plate.
Taps that one foul.
All the weight on the ball to his feet. His follow through takes him right toward first base. That, I think that's part of the reason why he drives the ball so well and surprises us a little bit with the distance in which he hits balls.
A little tap past the mound. Hayes is in. Hayes cannot come up. We'll see how they score. He'd have thrown him out if he could make the play. It'll go as an infield hit for Javi.
Like he tried to scoop it right there. Ball was not on the ground. It just hit him in a bad spot. Right in the pocket. Surprised they gave Javi a hit, but he'll take it.
Absolutely. Here's Mark Lemke, 0 for 9 in his career against Greg Harris. And Kent Merker moves on deck. Right back to the mound. Fine defensive plays out there, and the inning is over. And Harris really helped himself with a good defensive play. 1-6-3 DP and out for Atlanta in the second. One hit, no runs, no errors, nobody left. We go to the bottom half of the second inning. Atlanta leads it 1-0.
The National League Baseball Club. And is intended solely for the entertainment of our audience. Any publication, rebroadcast, retransmission, or the use of the pictures, descriptions, or accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Atlanta National League Baseball Club is prohibited. And at the conclusion of today's game, we'll be selecting the armor all protectant player of the game.
Well, actually, that will be done by Pete and Don. Joe and I will be selecting the player of the game for a different sponsor over on radio.
Thank you for that clarification.
You're welcome. Andres Galarraga leads off the bottom of the second. Outside, one ball, no strikes. Houston eliminated Phoenix today, 104-94 the final. Galarraga having a banner year, hitting .313, 14 homers, 39 RBI. Line fouled on the first base line.
Andres Galarraga near the top in so many different categories in the National League. He is swinging a big bat right now. 14 homers.
The Jensen and Quinn families here from Pocatello, Idaho, rooting for the Braves. Tap right back where it came from. One away. Merker is shut down, four in a row. Big Braves fan Dwayne Galima here rooting for the Atlanta team. The Davey family wants us to remember them to everybody in Pocatello, Idaho, but we don't have time to do that. The wind and the pitch. Charlie Hayes takes it down and in. One ball, no strikes.
I talked to some guys today by the batting cage, Skip. We talked about this being a regional franchise, but a newspaper that sent their sports writer to cover the Rockies from North Platte, Nebraska.
That's your ex-part of the world, huh?
They're coming here from everywhere.
Fastball up and in. Everybody felt this franchise had a chance to be successful, but I don't think anyone would look you in the eye and say they thought it would be as sensational as it has been. Ground ball to short. Blauser ranges to his left in between hops. Guns him down, two away. Hayes off to a very slow start with the bat. Just four homers, 15 RBIs. He's hitting close to 240.
Three ground ball outs already for Kent, too. That's a good sign. He's keeping the ball down.
Jones just called up. His first game was last night. He was 2-for-4. He was hitting 291 at AAA ball at Colorado Springs. 297 make it before he got the call. There's the strength, 0-1.
He will be sharing time in center field with Mike Kingery, a left-handed batter who we'll probably see tomorrow
against Greg Maddux. Down and in. Tomorrow's game starts at the same time today's did, Eastern Time. What would that be? It would be 3 o'clock.
Yes, sir.
Upstairs.
After tomorrow's game, the Braves return home, of course, to take on the Astros, but 22 of the next 28 games after Sunday, home games for the Braves.
Yeah, we've got two road trips of 3 days each. I hate them. One to San Francisco, it's just a terrible waste of money. The money it spends, you spend to fly all the way out there. You're going to have to come back and hit, Chris. 3-2. I think this schedule makers are from up east, and they think that every trip is like going from Philadelphia to New York. They don't understand. Line off Merker. I don't know if he's all right or not. He throws to first, gets him out, and comes trotting off, but I don't know exactly where that got him. Javi Lopez waits for him to make sure he's okay, but he says he is. Boy, went after that ball like the competitor that he is. 1-2-3, nothing doing. At the end of two, Atlanta leads at 1-0. 1-1. A little bit out in front on that one.
When he got to the dugout, it was like he was going to let the trainers look at him, but he didn't want them to interrupt his trek to the plate.
Even
up there.
If he'd broken his arm, he still wanted to hit. Now he wishes he'd have let them look at it a little longer. One out in the third. And here's Deion Sanders, who singled, stole a base, advanced to third on a wild pitch, and scored the Atlanta run on a double play off the bat of Tony Tarasco. Now we'll keep an eye on Merker and see if any further work is done on him. Apparently not. It's good. A lot of tickets remain for a series with Houston coming up. Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. 2,000 remaining for Tuesday, 10,000 for Wednesday, 2,500 for Thursday. Looped into short right field, Bichette coming on, still coming, he dives, and he made the catch. Good play.
You hear a lot about Dante Bichette's bat. Very underrated in the outfield. He covers a lot of ground for a big guy, and he has one of the better throwing arms in the National League.
So two are gone here, and Jeff Blauser is the batter. He walked his first time. Tony Tarasco moves on deck. Going to try him again. I don't know if anybody can get to this ball all the way to the wall. And Blauser stands at second with a two-out double. That makes the play by Bichette on Sanders that much more important. Tony Tarasco will be the batter.
You know, you're even better than I thought. You know, last night you kept talking about Blauser each at bat, getting a little stronger, a little better. And even today, look at you. He keeps hitting the ball a little farther each time.
I know. Tarasco hit the ball sharply his first time, but into a 6-4-3 twin killing. Blauser gets a good lead at second. Line drive, right field, base hit. Here comes Blauser. Bichette up, and he concedes it. Now Galarraga can't come up with a cutoff throw, and it's 2-0. I don't know what Bichette was thinking about. He just lollipopped the ball back in. Tarasco thought that the play was going to the plate. He was running with his head down and thus was able to get an extra base.
Well, that was a bad play on Bichette's part. He was third in the National League last year in assists, and this was a hard hit ball. He knew that Blauser was going with two outs, but as he came up to throw, he just broke down almost, decided just to lob it in, and that made it tough on Galarraga.
Yeah, if he just throws the ball hard to Galarraga, they've got Tarasco at second. As it is, another runner in scoring position with two out from McGriff. Out in front of the curve, 0-1. Tarasco needed that solid hit. They've been few and far between for him because of lack of playing time in recent days. It's his fifth RBI of the year.
Jeff huffing and puffing after a double and scoring on a single.
I don't understand that, too. I got on the elevator at the hotel last night, went up to the room, hardly out of breath.
Good night's rest, boy. That'll be amazing, huh?
They have one of those every trip. The 1-1 pitch. Into the dirt, Girardi. He's like a groundhog down there. He really blocks everything.
I had fun talking before the ball game with Don Zimmer about Girardi and about his ability to block balls. And being an old Brooklyn Dodger, I asked him about Roy Campanella. And he said that Campanella used to just try to push the ball out in front of him, not try to block it, and then dare you to take the extra base.
Fast strike outside corner.
He said he was so quick for a big man and didn't have a great arm, but he said he had like an infielder's arm, real quick release. He was always throwing sinkers to second.
The 2-2 to McGriff. Full count. David Justice waits on deck. A strikeout, a looping liner to right on which Bichette made a good play. Then a long Blauser double and a solid Tarasco single has given Atlanta its second run of the day.
You got to feel good for that guy, too, getting a start first time in over a month.
Got him with a curveball, and the inning is over. Strikeout number two for Harris, but the Braves pick up a run on two hits. They leave one. Bottom half of the third inning about to unfold here with the Braves on top. It's 2-0. Joe Girardi leads off the third. Merker has been perfect through two innings. Girardi hitting .234, seven runs driven in. That's high, one ball, and no strikes. Braves up by 2.5 over Montreal coming into the day's game. Florida 4 games out. New York 5.5. Philadelphia 8. On the outside corner, it's 1-1. And the Phillies 9 out on the left side. Braves have won 7 out of 10. Rockies have lost 3 in a row and 7 of 11.
Merker seems to still have a good fastball after taking that line drive off his arm, but I'll bet he feels it. He keeps looking down at it a little bit, I bet he feels it when he really follows through and snaps his wrist down on his fastball delivery.
Nelson Liriano awaits on deck. First, McGriff will take it himself, one away. That's seven in a row set down by Merker. Liriano was 0 for 2 last night. He's hitting .233 for the year.
Bobby Cox had an interesting comment to me when I was asking him about Avery last night and why he came out after eight innings. And he said, if you notice on our guys, he said they go through bursts where they seem to be throwing the ball great, like Glavin in Cincinnati the other day, where he had a good inning. He said, but then he comes in after the seventh, and he says he's completely out of gas. They just, it's like they get to a point where they give you all they've got, and then they just fall off the edge a little bit.
1-0, the count to Liriano. Two balls, no strikes. Grounded to McGriff again. Again, he'll take it himself and win the race. Two down. Greg Harris, not a bad hitter. .222 for the year.
In the game he beat the Braves last year, he had a couple of hits. Did some damage with the bat.
Check, swing, strike, 0-1.
Impressive thing about Merker's first trip through the order here, only one ball hit out of the infield.
Low and away, it's a ball and strike. The Nuggets Jazz game is underway, so you'll be hearing various moans, groans, and cheers from the crowd, all of whom are listening to that on their transistor radio. A ball and two strikes. And the inning is over, and Merker picks up his first strikeout of the game. 1-2-3, nothing doing at the end of three. So far, so good. Atlanta leads it 2-0. You want to cancel your bet?
Only one other game underway in the National League at Chicago, and the flags must be starched straight out. Matt Williams, a homer for the Giants. Bouchel and Sosa, homers for Chicago. Everything else later on. In the American League, Detroit has a home run from Chad Kruder. Baltimore trailing New York. Yankees got five in the first. Cleveland and Toronto going at it pretty hot and heavy. Molitor's homered for Toronto. Everything else in the American League will get underway later on. And every weekend evening and all weekend long, turn to the Headline News Sports Ticker for all the scores. That'll keep you up to date.
That's always a good bet. And David Justice leads off the fourth inning. And lines one in the center, and a good start for Atlanta. David is 1 for 2. Terry Pendleton, the batter. For Atlanta, that's five hits off Greg Harris. Galarraga and Justice talk things over. What do millionaires under the age of 30 talk about when they get together? I wonder. Mutual funds, I guess, and stuff like that.
Toys, I think.
What?
Toys.
Toys? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Adult toys.
Like adult toys.
Mercedes and stuff yes. like that.
I'm glad you used the plural of that.
You try. The stretch. Pendleton, there's a solid base hit to left field. And two are on with nobody out. A rifle shot off Terry's bat. And the Braves have something going in the fourth. Two on, nobody out.
Stayed right on that pitch. As we mentioned last night, he seems to be putting one good swing on the ball every night or afternoon. This is certainly a good one here. Maybe you can get two or three together today. Guy drove down and threw that ball. He wasn't falling away from it at all.
Javi Lopez is the batter. The wind is swirling around here. Breaking ball for a strike. It's 0-1.
Wind shifted again.
Blowing toward the right field line now. 0-2. Javi was given an infield hit when Hayes couldn't come up with a little infield roller his first time. Mark Lemke waits on deck. Four of the last five Atlanta batters have gotten hits. Curve, double play ball. 6-4-3. Second DP of the day for Atlanta. Runner at third. Two out.
He got away with a high breaking ball that time. Lucky Lopez hit it on the ground. Three straight curves, but he did get the double play, and now a runner at third with two out.
Lopez now, unfortunately, is tied for the league lead in DPs grounded into with Matt Williams. He has eight of them. And Mark Lemke bats with a runner at third, two out. That'll end the inning. Mariano Fields throws, inning over, and Harris gets out of a mess. No runs, two hits, no errors, one left. Bottom half of the fourth inning rolls round. Braves lead 2-0.
Braves enjoying a 2-0 league and lead in time to check out the Aflac trivia question, which today says, who holds the major league record for most times caught stealing in one game? I'll let you know the answer to this top half of the next inning.
That's not you, is it?
I hope not.
Walt Weiss is the batter. Hal brings up a good point. First, the pitch to Weiss. High and outside, one ball, no strike. Hal Galima says, I would never say this.
Oh, no, I know what you're going to say. You can just forget it. Because there were many opportunities.
Yeah. No, what Hal said was, this is major league, not at Albuquerque. Two balls, no strike. Well, let's see. We're playing the Rockies. That may have something to do with it. There's always a clue. High drive into center field. Dion is there waiting. And he puts it away for the first out. 10 in a row set down by Kent Merker.
Dwight Evans could be a choice there.
Or Don Baylor.
Don Baylor.
There's a couple of possibilities. By the way, we have bad news to report. Pitcher Armando Reynoso, a tear of the ulnar collateral ligament in his right elbow. All options are being discussed, but surgery is a probability, and if that's almost certain what they're going to have to do. That would mean the year is over for Armando Reynoso, and you hope he can get ready for 95. And it's straight to Eric Young.
Al Galima just told me some other news that adds to their misery right now.
The pitch to Young. There's a line drive. What a play by McGriff. He took a base hit away with an outstanding play. Two down.
It's got to be tough at first or third base today, picking up line drives with the shirt sleeves right behind home plate. Bright backdrop. But Fred able to go up the ladder to haul this one in. Al Galima telling me that the Rockies have got to play 60 games in the next 60 days. They get a couple of off days in there, but they've got some doubleheaders to make up some rain dates. So they're going to be mighty busy.
And Cincinnati comes in here next. That one slipped.
Let's hope. That's the tight pitch you saw from Browning. Another one last night from Reynoso, and you hope that it was a slip. You may need to look at the pitcher to find out if he's all right.
That was almost a strike to Galarraga on the on-deck circle. Yeah. fastball on the corner. It's 1-1.
Shit, really diving into the plate on Merker.
2-1.
He has gone 13 straight games without a homer. One of the longest stretches he's been through as a Rocky.
Let up outside. 3-1 is now the count.
And the team as a whole has gone 3 straight here at Mile High Stadium without a homer, and that matches a team high that they set last April. I should say April of 93.
Strike 2. Oh. Bichette was on his way to first and has to be called back. By the way, your guess on the Aflac question was almost as bad as mine. Player that's still playing and he's not involved in this game today. He is in the National League. And he's from West Palm Beach, Florida. That's all I'm going to tell you.
Well, I know the answer to that one.
Strike 3 call, inning over. Bichette called out on strike. Strikeout number 2 for Avery. He's faced 12 men in the game. He's gotten them all out. You don't suppose, do you? At the end of 4, 2-0 Atlanta. Kent Merker leads off the 5th inning. The first pitch to him is a strike. One of the Preaknesses later today at Pimlico, which reminds me of a story. Inside, it's 1-1. A horse walks into a saloon. Bartender looked up as the horse sat down on the bar stool and said, "What's the matter? Why the long face?" 1-2, the count.
At the end of the joke?
Well, that was my only horse race joke I could think of in short term.
So that's it, huh?
That's it. Why is this man holding this card up? What does this mean? That means we're going to have the answer to the Aflac trivia question eventually. Fouled away, it's still 1-2.
You gave me too big a clue earlier. I think I know who it is now.
He had a good cut. Only trouble was it was late. One out and now, what you've all been waiting for.
Who holds the major league record for most times caught stealing in a game? Robbie Thompson's from West Palm Beach.
And that happens to be the correct answer.
Didn't quite get a good jump that night, did he?
Wonder who threw him out those 4 times. That'll be tomorrow's Aflac trivia question. One is the count. The Nuggets and Jazz are struggling hard to get into double digits before the first quarter ends in their game. The 0-1 pitch. Right through there, it's 0-2. Bounces up there. It's 1-2.
Wind seems to be picking up here a little bit.
Yes, it does, Joe. Ever since the Aflac trivia question got out of the way, it's been blowing a gale. curve, looped, another hit for Sander. He's going for two, and he is in there. It'll be a single and an error on Jones. He bobbled it for just a moment, but that's all Dion needed.
Jones hesitated on charging the ball. He wanted to play it on a good hop and instead got handcuffed a little bit right here, right off the heel of his glove. And I tell you what, Dion turned on the jets right there because he was almost at a full stop and still made it.
Jeff Blauser is the batter. He's walked, he's doubled, he's scored. Braves trying to add on to a 2-0 lead. High fly ball right field. Sanders is going to tag as Bichette makes the catch. Here's the catch. Here's the throw. Here he comes, and he is in there. Blauser is retired. It's up to Tarasco. Drove in a runner's last time. Runner third, two out.
Done.
The first run in this game, excuse me, Joe, scored when Tarasco hit into a double play, the other on his solid single.
I was just going to say that his solid single instrumental there with two outs, and that's something that the Rockies have not been getting, and that's what's been driving Don Baylor and Dwight Evans a little crazy, just the fact that they've had some runners on base but can't get anybody home. Don Zimmer was telling me about the last game against the Dodgers. Mike Kingery was at third base three times, twice with less than two outs, and they couldn't get him home any of those opportunities.
So Tarasco ready to stand in there with Sanders at third. Harris will pitch off the stretch. Right, Tony T waits. Curve outside, evens it up with a ball and a strike. Swing, the ball pops away. He did not swing. Count goes to 2-1.
You know, I was just sitting here thinking about Reynoso and what a tough break it is. We all upset, disappointed for him and the Rockies. But one thing about last night, remember, you know, he's pitching against his former teammates. Remember, he threw some breaking balls early in the ball game that bounced way out in front of home plate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he may have been trying last night a little too hard, making sure that he snapped off some good breaking balls. Maybe that led to the injury. I guess we'll never know, but something to think about.
That's well hit into right field. Bichette going back, still going. That ball is out of here. A two-run homer for Tony Tarasco. He hit it against the wind, and he hit it more than 400 feet. He has three RBIs on the day, and it's 4-0 Atlanta. First home run of the game, the 21st in 8.5 games for Atlanta in this ballpark.
And another two-out hit. And again, his first start since April 17th, and boy, is he making the most of it. Fastball.
You hear coaches say swing down on the ball. Back live, McGriff takes low and inside. Well, here's a guy who really does it. He really chops down on the ball.
And gives you an idea of what can happen when you meet the ball squarely with that swing. Ball really carries.
That's low, and it's 2-0. Squibb foul down the first baseline. Tarasco had been 0 for 12 with runners in scoring position until his third inning single and subsequent fifth inning homer. 4-0 Atlanta. Ground ball, foul pass first.
No telling how far that home run might have gone if the wind hadn't been blowing in.
It was a pretty good poke as it was. don't know if it happens to pitchers or not, but when you've got a lineup with Sanders and Blauser and McGriff and Justice and Pendleton, you get first time perhaps that you play a team, you get to a Tarasco or a Lopez or a Cuesco, maybe you ease up just a little bit. But they'll make you pay. Fred just did damage to a very expensive camera down there in the third base camera position.
Let's hope it was theirs.
Well, better that than the cameraman is the way I look at it. Sorry, can't say that anymore. Camera person. Lined left field base hit. He might get more than one. Over quickly up with it is Young, but McGriff will cruise into second. He just flicked his wrist and steered it into left field. So he's in scoring position with two out.
He struck him out last time on a good curveball. Tried to come back with a changeup this time for the out, and Fred stayed with the pitch a little better. Hit it in a great spot where nobody was.
4-9-0 for the Braves. 0-0-1 for the Rockies in the fifth. Upstairs, one ball, no strikes. Justice singled his last time. He's one out of two. A right-hander up and throwing in their bullpen. Ken Buttonfield is up. A base hit to the outfield here would almost certainly mean another run because their outfield is placed so deep. Wind blowing in again here. It's once more shifted. Just outside. Terry Pendleton waits on deck.
Here's a case, I think, where Harris is trying to avoid further damage. He's trying to be careful with Justice. First base open. But he might wind up getting more trouble by walking him and having to face Terry with runners at first and second.
There's a strike. It's 2-1. McGriff at second with two out. Strike two over the inside corner. Same spot. It's 2-2. But outside, he's run it full. 3-2 to David Justice.
He's made a couple of good pitches inside to David here, but I don't think 3-2 he'd be willing to go back in there again. Probably wants David to go after his curveball or his changeup away. Let's see how he works it. Watch Girardi and watch where he sets up. Give you a pretty good idea what the pitch is going to be. If he moves inside, it'll probably be a fastball.
Just did stay alive. Still 3-2.
Like a changeup. That was the pitch he was trying to throw McGriff, but left it too close to the plate for Fred.
He chased a bad ball, and the inning is over. Big breaking curveball. Fourth strikeout for Harris, but the Braves score two times with three hits. There was one error. The runs are earned, however, and one man is left. The end of 4.5. Pete and Don join you now. You score Braves 4, Rockies nothing.
Four to nothing. Pete Manweir and Don Sutton with you for the rest of this one. Andres Galarraga to lead it up. Kent Merker has set down 12 in a row. Well, Pete, a couple things we could talk about. It looks like Tony Tarasco would like a little more turf time.
He has really accounted for all four Atlanta runs, a two-run homer, a run-scoring single, the other run scoring in the first inning when Tarasco hit into a double play. So he is making the most of this start here against the Rockies.
No balls and two strikes to Galarraga. And the second thing, are you superstitious?
Not about this.
Merker has the stuff to do it again, doesn't he?
So far, fastball and changeup. He's been able to spot all but one of them. That one pitch that got away from him just about where he's wanted to all afternoon long.
Does pitching ever amaze you when you see an inning like that where Merker throws a changeup that hits about a third of the way up the screen and then two pitches later makes as perfect a knee-high outside corner on the black pitch as you can see?
No, because I saw Steve Dalkowski pitch once.
On the ground, base hit. Just inside the bag, and Galarraga has a single. And before you start writing and calling in, neither one of us threw the pitch, and it has absolutely nothing to do with it.
Lopez wanted the breaking ball outside, and that's where Kent Merker put it, but Galarraga just stayed with the pitch. And remember, he won the National League batting title last year, and you don't get to do things like that unless you can hit the ball to all fields.
At a hanging curveball that he singles on. First base hit of the day, and it'll bring up Charlie Hayes. Hardy on the fastball. Hayes last time up hit a grounder to short. Braves would take that in a heartbeat. What a perfect day for baseball here in Denver, Colorado. You could not ask for better. Change up, lined in the left. Back-to-back singles have put him at first and second, and it'll bring up Chris Jones. And I believe, Pete, you're going to see on this pitch, if we have a replay of it, that this baby may have been right on top of the plate.
Here's another look at it. Well, he really had to go down, almost pick that ball off his shoe tops.
A little seven iron shot has put Charlie Hayes at first, Galarraga at second. Jones tapped back to the pitcher his last time up. Lays off the high fastball to count 1-0. Another crowd that's going to push 65 or 70,000 here, and with the Denver Nuggets and the Utah Jazz playing in the NBA playoffs. Swing and a miss by Jones, 1-1. A lot of these fans have figured out how to enjoy their own version of a doubleheader.
That's right. They're out here live to watch the Braves and Rockies play, and I'll bet you 80% of them either have a radio or one of those handheld TVs catching the action in the Nuggets-Utah game.
Yeah, one eye on the baseball game, one eye on the TV, and one on the scoreboard. In fact, Jones might have gone back for a little lighter bat. One ball, one strike. Jones up here because Ellis Burks out from 4 to 6 weeks. Ligament damage, and I don't know if Skip or Joe might have told you folks, but the news not good on Armando Reynoso.
A torn ligament.
So send along your best wishes and thoughts. He's a good guy. You never want to see anybody hurt. 2-2. That woke somebody up in the Rockies dugout. Every now and then, umpires have a laugh when that goes in there because so many times players in the dugout will get on the umpires when they get one foul off their shins and off their masks. So it's nothing malicious, but it's kind of a little chortle every now and then when one goes into the dugout. Once you see nobody's hurt. Got him. Strikeout number three for Merker.
And again, he went with a changeup. You see Lopez bring that ball back just a shade of an inch. Ball might have been a quarter of an inch off the plate, but Lopez, when he caught it, made it look like a strike.
If he catches that pushing out to get it, Noah, he's not going to get that
call.
Would
not have gotten the call, no.
Good job of framing the strike. One out for Joe Girardi. Girardi hit one off the end of the bat. Right to McGriff his first time up. A strike to Girardi, and it's 0-1. Girardi was commenting to Dave Campbell, one of the announcers who covers the Rockies here on TV last night, about Tony Tarasco's swing. He said, were they playing hit and run? Because he looked like he was just trying to chop down on everything. Well, he got a close hand look, close up look today at why he was trying to hit down on the ball. Carrasco with that home run has hit the ball hard three times.
And that's his natural swing.
One ball, one strike. You remember when we first came in here, we had talked about the fact that Don Baylor a little upset at some clutch hitting, some effort, some wanted a little more excitement, enthusiasm. Joe Girardi, a guy who has struggled with men in scoring position in the situation he's in right now, hitting less than 150. Galarraga at second, Hayes at first, one out. With the exception of one outing, has pitched well as a starter, and Pete, I honestly find it a little bit amazing that he can have his schedule so juggled and still be as consistent as he's been as a starter.
First time he's pitched today in 10 days, and I rode out in the cab with Kemp this morning, and he was already wondering when his next start would be, and he's got it figured out won't be until against the Cubs next weekend.
Runners on the move. The throw, got him. Well, Baylor said he was going to shake things up, and this time he may have run himself right into an easy out at third.
Trying to make something happen here, and Galarraga's out easily. The throw to Pendleton. You can see the tag made long before Galarraga got to the bag at third. Got him right there.
Hayes ends up at second, but he doesn't get a stolen base because the lead runner got thrown out. If Galarraga had been safe, then both would have been credited with steals. In the air, right side, McGriff over near the stands, but I think this is going to get out of play.
$72,123 the paid attendance here this afternoon. $72,123. And you know, they were worried before the game that about they were afraid they were going to have about 20,000 no-shows because of the basketball game. Not many no-shows here at all today.
Averaging 55,651. One and two to Girardi.
They drew 4.48 million people last year, and Bob Gebhardt told us before the game today they're going to exceed that this year.
Amazing. Did you ask him? First, we'll see what happens on this pitch. I know you had him on the pregame show on radio. Change up, ball two. Did you ask him what they thought about? Did they think they had done it wrong by downsizing that stadium? The new one?
The new one? Well, they initially had planned for only a 38,000 seat stadium, but it's up to 50 now. They've added 12,000 seats to their initial plans based on the remarkable turnouts they've been having here in Colorado that no one could have forecasted. There's Bob Gebhardt, good guy.
The 2-2. Down low, three balls and two strikes.
Gebhardt was talking about how he was criticized for going out and signing free agents Walt Weiss and Ellis Burks and Howard Johnson and giving up second, third, and fourth round draft picks for this year to get veteran players like that. But he had a reason for doing it.
Out of play? What were his reasons?
He said, we're not going to be able to get free agent pitchers to come over here because nobody wants to pitch in Denver with a thin air. So after he gets Walt Weiss locked into a long-term contract, that takes care of his middle infield for a while at short. He was able to trade Freddie Benavides to the Montreal Expos for two pitching prospects. And that's how they're going to try to develop their pitching, by trading players for other organizations' young pitchers and developing them into major league pitchers.
You got a chance to look at Mr. McMorris there. He's the boss man. There's ball four. That's the first walk issued by Kent Merker.
This was a call that Kent Merker didn't get. He's been getting these borderline calls pretty much all afternoon long, but that one, ball four. But that's going to be Denver's philosophy, that they believe that they're not going to be able to get a lot of free agent pitchers to come, so they're going to have to draft well. And they're also going to have to be able to make deals for young pitching prospects in other organizations and try to develop them and also trade for other pitchers.
Nelson Liriano is the batter. He takes a strike and it's 0-1. They seem to have created a good structure here from Jerry McMorris, as you got to look at, right all the way down to the field. The guys who, if they have egos, then they kind of back them up a little bit, and they all seem to work well together.
That's a very solid organization.
No balls, one strike. Hayes at second, Girardi at first. Breaking ball inside, 1-1.
A very solid organization when you consider that 3 years ago when Bob Gebhardt was first named to that general manager's position, he came to Atlanta on a scouting trip, and I asked him how everything was going. He said, well, you know, we haven't even got a paperclip yet. They had absolutely nothing yet. To start from scratch and to build a team, a very difficult assignment, takes a lot of work.
That's going to get into the stands on one hop, still 1-2. And less than a year away from having a brand new ballpark to play in. They drew that $4.4 million in 79 dates last year. Two and two. Nobody on the field expects Liriano to pull Merker. Everybody swung around toward the right side. Justice and Sanders deep, shallow in the outfield. And that's another 3-2 count to Nelson Liriano. You got a picture a little while ago of Bob Gebhardt up in his box. Seated next to him was Walt Jocketty, a guy that I got to know with the Oakland A's, who is assistant general manager, and then an old friend of everybody around the Braves organization, Paul Agins. On the ground and foul, still 3-2.
Paul sent us a note wanting to say hello to his mother Jackie and sister Paula in Columbus, Georgia, and his brother Chris watching in Tallahassee, Florida. Paul said he wants to make all of them aware that they should come out, and we're talking to folks in Georgia and Florida, they should come out and enjoy some of this beautiful Colorado weather.
Yeah, he is really excited about being here. Payoff pitch to Nelson Liriano. Hayes and Girardi on the move. And another close one goes the other way. Back-to-back walks, the bases are loaded. And Don Baylor will go to his bench.
And again, a borderline call here that Merker didn't get. He's been getting this call some of the time. But the last two times on 3-2 pitches, well, there was really nothing borderline about that pitch. That was way off the plate.
And, Pete, you're getting an example right here of something you and I were talking about over on radio. What you try to tell a guy like Harris is when he's out there trying to save those runs, that if you can keep it at 4-0, that's like being 2-0 anyplace else. And now here's what you're talking about. Bases loaded, one base hit. The Rockies are right back in this ballgame.
Yeah, especially in the daytime here. Daytime games here are normally very high scoring.
4-9-0 for the Braves, 0-2-1 for the Rockies. Bases are loaded on two walks.
We should advise our fans, if you hear some strange roars from this crowd coming at unusual times when nothing much is going on in the baseball game, something is going on in the NBA game. That's why the crowd reacts at unusual moments. We had a great story about that in the Dodger game earlier in the week. It was the ninth inning. Nothing was going on in this game. Kent Bottenfield was out pitching. And the Denver game ended with the Nuggets winning it. And all of a sudden, this huge roar went up at Mile High Stadium with nothing going on. Bottenfield was stunned by it, had to step off the mound. That could happen again today.
Schaefer is the hitter, hits this one up the chimney. That's going to be a tough one for Fred McGriff, battling the sun, the wind, and snow cone, but he got it. Nice job by McGriff, nice job by Merker. Pitching out of the jam, the Rockies got two singles and two walks, but came up empty. 5 in the books, 4-0 Braves. Top of the sixth, 4-0 Braves. The Rockies' new pitcher, right-hander Kent Bottenfield. There's the man you were talking about, Pete. Bottenfield making his fifth appearance, 1-0 record, 4-7 earned run average in seven innings. He has allowed 8 hits, walked 3, struck out 6. The league hitting 276 against the big right-hander. He came over from the Montreal Expos. You have to know that the people here knew a little bit about him. He had been a starter reliever for Montreal in 92-93. They traded Butch Henry even up to get Bottenfield. Out of James Madison High School in Portland, Oregon. Good athlete in high school. Three-sport letterman, football, basketball, and baseball. Not a whole lot of free time for him in school. 0-1 to Pendleton. Right now makes his home in Royal Palm Beach down in Florida. Number of folks on this ball club make their permanent residence down in the neighborhood of the Braves training camp. Which incidentally, according to my Access Atlanta computer, talks are continuing very swimmingly with Jupiter Beach about the new facility for 96. 1-1 to count to Pendleton.
I've been amazed at you on this road trip. You didn't bring your golf clubs. You just brought your laptop computer.
Wait till you see my little plastic pen holder I'm bringing next trip. Ground ball right at Galarraga. Foot race is on, and the Big Cat wins it.
It's time now for the Advance Auto Parts Home Run of the Week, and this week we salute Javier Lopez. Last Sunday in New York, the Braves catcher belted his second home run of the day to ensure a 6-1 victory over the Mets. Advance Auto Parts will donate $1,000 to the Make-A-Wish Foundation of America to help ensure that wishes are granted to children with terminal illness.
The batter is Javi Lopez, a single and a second, hit into a 6-4-3 double play. Braves have grounded into a couple of twin killings. Javi just a shade under 300. His home run last night is 9th. He now has 24 RBIs. That's number 2 on the ball club. 1-1. That'll get out of play. It's 1-2. You know, you were talking about there. They're feeling like they're going to have a difficult time getting free agent pitchers to come here. Just think what a hero and what a household word the pitch to Lopez, 2-2. What a big hero a free agent pitcher was, who was a legitimate good one, who was very secure, knew how to pitch, and wouldn't mind giving up 4 runs a game, would become if he would make it known that he would come here and would play here.
Oh, yeah.
He'd be a star. To right field, that is a tee shot, could be 2. Lopez is going to try to stretch it. The throw to second, a double. Good base running by Javi Lopez and some good defensive play by Chris Jones.
During the team meeting this week, one of the things that was reminded, reminder that was passed along to all the Braves hitters, if you hit a ball in the gap in right center field, even if an outfielder gets to it, that's still about 400 feet away, and you still got a good chance to make it to second base. So don't give up in a ball just because you see a hitter get to it before it gets to the wall. If it gets to the wall, it's a triple.
Base hit here would be a little insurance. Mark Lemke has struggled today. He's grounded into a 1-6-3 double play and grounded to second. Takes the breaking ball downstairs. Another good stop by Joe Girardi. And we sound like a broken record the last 2 days saying nice stop Girardi, nice stop Lopez. But both of them have had a ton of opportunities to block those balls in the dirt. Curveball strike, 1-1. In the air and out of play, it's 1-2 to Lemke. Somebody booted it. And they're paying for it. You can see what a gorgeous day it is here in Denver, and also what Pete was talking about, a very few empty seats. 72,000. Another good stop by Joe Girardi. It's been a good road trip for Lemke. Granted, he's 0 for 2 today, but he's 18 out of his last 46. And hitting right at 500 for the road trip. And he's pushed his batting average right back up in the neighborhood of 300. Most of that good hitting coming from the left side of the plate. Deep to right field. Late jump by Bichette. And it's going to be off the wall. Lopez had to wait to see if it was caught instead of being halfway to third. So Lemke is going to get a double and he's not going to get an RBI.
Lopez, thinking this ball was going to be caught, was getting ready to tag up and advance to third after the catch. This ball hit about 415 feet off the wall in right center, and only now does Lopez start to run. So you've got back-to-back doubles, and the result, runners at second and third. You see Lopez getting ready to tag up and then taking off, but by the time he got to third, he had to hold up.
Infield in for Kent Merker, and there's a strike. That's one of those you go stand near third, and if they catch it, you hot foot back to second, don't you?
Probably would have been a better idea.
Merker fouls one off his foot, and it's 0-2. Kent's going to want hazardous duty pay, too. May have broken his bat.
Didn't hit it too hard.
Remember, early in the ballgame, Merker got a line drive off his left arm. Now he's fouled one off his foot. And he did break his bat, so Merker has a new piece of timber. A baseball oddity, back-to-back doubles and nobody scores. Grounder to first. Galarraga will make the tag. No advance by Lopez or Lemke. Two outs. We want to say hello to Pete. We want to say hi to Greg Maddux, who's sitting with his feet propped up in the clubhouse charting this one.
Yes, we understand they get our feed of the game down in the Braves locker room.
And I know right now he is still completely in uniform with his spikes on and hat and catching every pitch. Two outs for Deion Sanders. You see what he's done today. He was in a 3-for-21 streak and needed some hits. Another nice stop by Joe Girardi.
This situation that Deion's been delivering in all year long with a runner at third. Deion is hitting, are you ready? 800.
Holy cow. To borrow a phrase. Lopez at third, Lemke at second, two gone. He can't stay back on the breaking ball, and it's 1-1. Deion Sanders having to make some adjustments. His second timer pitchers see him this year. He's getting a lot of changeups and a lot of breaking balls. The fastball inside, and it's 2-1. Breaking ball for a strike. Two balls, two strikes. right at Galarraga. Another nice play by Andres Galarraga. The Braves get back-to-back doubles here in the sixth inning and come up empty. No runs.
A reminder that we'll wrap up the road trip here at Mile High Stadium tomorrow, 3 o'clock Eastern time. Greg Maddux against rookie Lance Painter, who's just been called up from Colorado Springs. 3 o'clock Eastern time tomorrow here on TBS.
And we thank you. To the bottom of the sixth, Walt Weiss to lead it off, Young and Bichette to follow. The Braves lead it 4-0. 4 runs, 11 hits, and no errors for the Braves. Merker working on a two-hitter. Weiss has grounded to short and flied to center. Takes ball one down low. There's a strike, and it's 1-1. Weiss, 30 years old, out of Tuxedo, New York, Pete. That's a new one on me.
I believe that's down near New York City.
On the ground, good play, Lemke. One gone. And that'll bring up Eric Young, the left fielder. Young, a product of the Dodger organization. They signed him as a 43rd round selection. The first pitch to Young is a ball down low, 1-0. But he made it to the big leagues in less than 4 years. It's just a shade under 260 for the Dodgers in 92, and then was drafted by the Colorado Rockies.
Well, he has speed. If you have speed and you can develop a little bit of a hitting ability, doesn't matter where you were picked in the draft. If you've got that speed, that's one thing they can never take away from you. You can improve on the other parts of your game and still make it to the major leagues.
To center field. A late jump by Deion Sanders. That could be three for Young, who has that speed. But he decides to play it safe. Ball gets away from Lemke, and he makes it to third anyway. That's going to be a double by Young, and we'll see who they give the error to.
Over the head of Deion Sanders to dead center field, where it's 423 feet. And then the ball doesn't take much of a carom off that wall, and then Deion's throw back toward the infield, not a good one. He's going to be charged with the error, allowing Eric Young to go from second to third. Young had decided to settle for a double here, but then as soon as this throw goes over Blauser's head,
yeah,
he takes off and gets into third without a throw.
So the Rockies have a runner at third for Dante Bichette. The count 0-1. Pete, you and I were talking to Dave Campbell, one of their broadcasters, prior to the game about just what we saw happen there, how difficult it is for the center fielder sometimes to follow the ball here in this stadium the way it's structured.
It's a very high series of tiers here at Mile High Stadium, and especially in the daytime with all the reflections from the white shirts and caps and the lighter colored seats.
A base hit for Bichette, and the Rockies are on the scoreboard.
That is going to get the Braves bullpen stirring. Bichette driving in his 31st run of the year. Came right back over the heart of the plate. And Mike Stanton's going to go to work in the Atlanta bullpen along with.
Looks like Mark Wohlers.
Mark Wohlers.
So Bichette's at first, back-to-back hits. The Colorado Rockies are on the board, and that brings up Andres Galarraga. Bichette can run. He's 7 out of 9 this year in stolen bases. It was Galarraga who broke up Merker's string of 12 in a row with a leadoff single in the fifth inning. Right on by it, and it's 0-1. They're taking shots at us, and it's 0-2. What's your pitch count on Merker to here?
82.
Still not a very high total. Remember, he had some very easy innings, first, second, third. Okay, I've had enough. Still 0-2. That's Rick Char, producer engineer over in radio.
Look at that ball.
He hit just below
him. Just below him.
One ball, two strikes. Bichette is on the move. That's headed for the corner and gone.
You will not see a ball get out of any ballpark any quicker than that. A very powerful swing by Galarraga, and that ball hit on the line, and bang, it's in the seats already.
A little bit of a difference in a year for Galarraga. Last year he was hitting 390. This year right around 310. But that's his 15th homer, his 41st RBI already. So all of a sudden it's a ball game. The lead now 4-3 in favor of the Braves, and it's time for the Motorola Pagers call to the bullpen.
Andrés Galarraga just hit his 15th homer, driving in his 40th and 41st runs on a weekend when a broadcast team from his native Venezuela is here broadcasting these Rocky games back to Venezuela. He became the first native of that country to win a Major League batting title last year, and they're going to cover his exploits this season every now and then. We showed you Rick Shaw in our radio booth a moment ago. Rick came to the rescue of the Venezuelan radio team. They had a little accident prior to the game today. There is a thing called a crowd mic, folks, which we hang out over the edge of our broadcast booth down into the crowd to pick up the...
To get a little ambiance.
Get a little ambiance of the crowd. Well, they dropped their crowd mic over the... There's the crowd mic. You can see it hanging right there. They dropped their crowd mic over the front of their booth, but it wasn't attached to anything. Fell down into the crowd, so Rick had to loan them one for the rest of the day. But Radio Venezuela is here today.
It's a 4-3 ball game. Charlie Hayes is the batter. The new Braves pitcher, Mark Wohlers. Mark making his 18th appearance of the year. You see the numbers. 17 hits in 17 innings, 22 strikeouts, but 15 base on balls. And the first one to Hayes is low, 1-0. The Braves with one in the first, one in the third, two in the fifth. The Rockies with a three spot here in the bottom of the sixth inning. Two balls and no strikes. Yeah. Another one back our way, and it's 2-1. Perfect pitch. Two balls, two strikes. For those of you who want to speculate, this is game number 40 for Andres Galarraga. That home run is 15th. Back to 1961, Roger Maris hit his 15th homer in game number 45. Full count to Charlie Hayes. Payoff pitch to Charlie Hayes. Out of play, still 3-2. So you never get a lead and just kind of set back and coast here at Mile High
Stadium. Not this ballpark. Not with these hitters.
And remember, we told you yesterday, the guy who has the best batting average and has been the most consistent is going to be out for 4 to 6 weeks. Hayes stays alive. 3 balls, 2 strikes. Bottom of the sixth, one out. One more game on this road trip tomorrow. Greg Maddux against Lance Painter. Then an off day on Monday. Then the Houston Astros come to town for 3. On the ground. Safe. Nice play and a nice hustle by Mark Lemke and a nice job by Mark Lohler. But Hayes outlegs it. That may be an error on McGriff.
It will be an error charged to Fred McGriff. But Mark Lemke almost saved him here. After the ball gets away from McGriff, Lemke runs it down. Wohlers is there to take the throw. But Hayes sliding into first base got there safely. That was a much closer play than you might have thought.
Second error of the day committed by the Braves. Second error committed this inning. And it looks like Don Baylor is going to go to his bench again. And Howard Johnson, Hojo, is going to pinch hit for Chris Jones. Johnson hitting 200 on the nose. But 2 for 6 is a pinch hitter. And one of those hits, a 2-run homer. A switch hitter who will bat left against Mark Wohlers. Tying run at first. A strike to Johnson. We were mentioning earlier your conversation with Bob Gebhardt. And I guess of the free agent signees, this is the only one that fans have questioned.
Well, they consider it a little risky because Hojo was injured so much last year, and they wonder if he's going to be able to bounce back from all those injuries and become the player again that he used to be. But again, the Rockies feeling that they owe their fans, with this great support, they owe their fans the chance for this team to get good as quickly as possible because of the great support they've had here. So they want to get some established players here, that especially offensive side of the game, that can get them there a little quicker.
It's 1-1 to Howard Johnson. I don't think you can just automatically count them out of this Western Division. They're only 4.5 back right now. And with their ability to score any pitching at all, they can make a run at it.
That's why the loss of Reynoso hurts so much, because he had established himself as a starter that can win in this ballpark.
Good fastball from Wohlers, and it's 1-2 to Howard Johnson.
Even though he lost the game last night, Reynoso 9-4 in Mile High Stadium. So he's a pitcher who has found a way to win here, and now he's going to be probably out for the year. That's a tough blow to this club.
And in watching him last night pitch, one of his secrets may be he's not afraid to pitch inside in this ballpark. Pat Corrales and Bobby Cox afterwards marveling that he threw one slider after another in on Braves left-handed hitters. Must have been outside. 2-2. That'll take care of Howard Johnson. Wohlers records the strikeout, his first. Two outs for Joe Girardi.
A lot of strikeouts for Howard Johnson. That's the 29th time he has struck out in 86 at bats this year. So he's striking out of every three trips.
And Wohlers will try to get one more big out and leave Charlie Hayes standing at first. Girardi 0 for 1 officially. He hit one off the end of the bat to McGriff and he walked. Outside 1-0. Mike Stanton has let him know in the dugout that he is ready, and he is just standing with Charlie O'Brien and Ned Yost down in the bullpen. For a minute, I thought John Kruk was here. 2-0. Here's a strike, and it's 2-1. All of the room for Girardi in left center and in right center field. Tarasco playing straight away in deep and left. Sanders, medium depth in center. But look where David Justice is in right field, maybe 20 feet off the line and deep. A lot of real estate in the alleys for Joe Girardi. There goes Hayes. A grounder to Lemke, to McGriff, and that'll do it. Blauser was covering on that, and it's a good thing. Well, that'll put a lid on the sixth inning, but not before the Rockies battle back with a three spot. They do it on three hits, one Braves error, one left. We played six at Mile High Stadium. It's a 4-3 ball game. Howard Johnson is in left field and Mike Kingery in center. We move to the seventh. We also move over to Pete Van Wieren.
Okay, thank you, Don. Jeff Blauser leads off against Kent Botton Field and takes ball one. Jeff with a walk, a double, and a fly to right. 1-for-2 today. 3-for-7 since coming off the disabled list. That misses low. The count 2-0. Blauser, Tarasco, and McGriff do up here in the top of the seventh. And it's 3-0 now on Blauser. On four straight, Blauser walks to lead off the seventh. First walk given up by Botton Field. And here comes Tony Tarasco, who's had an excellent day. He has driven in three of the four Atlanta runs and accounted for the fourth one when he hit into a double play in the first inning. up to 319 for the year now. And with these left-handed bats coming, Don Baylor wants to get some left-handed pitching. So Mike Munoz will get the call from the Colorado Rockies bullpen with Blauser at first and nobody out here in the top of the seventh. Braves holding on to a one-run lead. Their leadoff man, Jeff Blauser, has just walked here in the seventh inning, and Mike Munoz comes on to replace Kent Bottenfield. Munoz makes his 18th appearance. 1-1 with an ERA of over 5, and control has been a problem. He has 11 walks in 12 and a third innings. Bottenfield worked an inning, allowed 2 hits, no runs yet. The runner at first is responsibility. 1 walk and no strikeouts. And with the left-handed pitcher coming on, Bobby Cox goes to a right-handed bat off the bench to pinch hit for Tarasco, Dave Gallagher, who homered here last night.
A lot of Georgia folks out in this area, Braves fans, Pete Lane and Mike Jones out here, Robert and Jenny McDermott of Fitzgerald, Georgia, Albert and Vera Gilfries from Poland, Georgia, celebrating their 38th wedding anniversary. Want to wish them a happy anniversary. And Ralph and Dee Fram from Marietta are out here too. So Braves fans every place we go.
Gallagher up to 234. Last night's home run was his second. He also has driven in 7 runs. 2 out of 11 as a pinch hitter. Braves had 2 home runs in the game last night. Lopez and Gallagher hitting them. The entire rest of the National League yesterday hit 1. Phil Plantier of San Diego hit the only other National League home run in the 7 games on the National League schedule last night. Nobody out, Blauser at first. Gallagher squaring, takes it high and away, ball one. Blauser chased back. Munoz, 28 years old, originally in the Dodger organization, then went to the Tigers for a few years. An L.A. native. Two and oh, the count on Gallagher. Just missed another home run.
Kind of a quiet crowd here right now. The Rockies are down by 1 and the Jazz are down by 10.
The Nuggets,
I mean,
you mean.
The Nuggets are down by 10. The Jazz are up by 10.
2-1 the count now on Dave Gallagher. The 2-1 on the way, he was squaring the bunt again and went after it, says plate umpire Rich Reeker. And Reeker, hearing from the Braves dugout, Bobby Cox all the way out on the top step to argue that call. It's 2-2.
Well, you be the umpire. Take a look. It looked like he got that one back.
2 balls, 2 strikes. Nobody out, Blauser at first. And again, he's chased back. Blown away, 3-2. The one thing that maybe has kept Mike Munoz from becoming a premier left-handed relief pitcher has been his control.
Certainly no question about his stuff. He has a couple of excellent pitches. He knows how to pitch down. in the strike zone, and when he is throwing strikes, gets a lot of ground ball outs.
Again to first.
And makes a lot of throws. Makes a lot of throws to first.
Three and two on Gallagher. Fred McGriff on deck. He has walked another one. And runners are at first and second with nobody out. Fred McGriff, one for two on the day, has walked, struck out, and doubled.
Well, I know a lot of managers like the lefty-lefty matchup, but look what McGriff is hitting against lefties lately. Almost 500 and five of them dingers.
He and David Justice both don't mind facing lefties at all. And the Braves setting the table here in the seventh, first and second with nobody out.
McGriff's a guy more of a fly ball hitter too, Pete. Didn't ground into too many double plays.
Another good stop by Girardi.
What's that now, by, would you guess? A dozen? Good stop?
Oh, more than that. There have been at least 25, I would say, in these two games that have been in the dirt that Girardi has stopped about 24 of. And now Larry Bernard is going to come out and have a word with Mike Munoz about throwing strikes. Almost to a man down on the field before the game, he talked to any of the Rockies people, be it manager Don Baylor, be it Don Zimmer, the third base coach, be it Larry Bernard, the pitching coach, be it Bob Gebhard, the Colorado Rockies GM. And he said, more than anything, when you play a team as good as Atlanta or like Cincinnati and Montreal, who are coming up next for the Colorado Rockies, you just cannot afford to give an extra out to these teams, whether it's by a defensive mistake or walking somebody. You've got to get people out and throw strikes. Steve Reed up now in the Colorado bullpen.
And if you have bad stuff, you can kind of see why you might want to nibble a little bit, but Munoz's stuff is good.
Here's the 1-0. Low, ball two.
Remember a meeting that Red Adams, the pitching coach for the Dodgers, had one day in a similar situation. He walked out and he said, son, we have eight men standing around here apparently for no reason.
Here's the 2-0. There's a strike, 2-1. Nobody out. Gallagher at first. Plowser at second. Braves leading it 4-3. Trying to beat the Rockies for a 15th consecutive time. On the ground toward second. This might be a double play. It will be. 4-6-3. Over to third, Blauser. That's the fourth double play turned by the Rockies today.
And only the fifth hit into by Fred McGriff, but that's as good as you can want it. A nice convenient hop to Liriano. He gives it to Weiss in time for him to set himself and make the good throw to first.
So now the runner at third, with two outs and David Justice the batter. Justice one for three, singled in the fourth inning. Upstairs, ball one. Here's the 1-0, and there's a line drive. Base hit left field. In to score, Jeff Blauser. And that makes it 5-3. Justice drives in his 11th run of the year. A run scoring single for David off a lefty.
No surprise to see Justice nail lefties. You were talking about it earlier. Watch how he stays back, doesn't commit, gets a ball up in the strike zone, doesn't try to pull it. A liner into left field, that's a big run. You'd like to add a little more cushion going into the last couple of innings against these guys.
Now Terry Pendleton, one for three, a base hit back in the fourth inning. He's also flied to right and grounded out to first. Off the glove of Munoz, fielded by Liriano. And that's all for Atlanta in the seventh. But the Braves add a run to their lead on the run-scoring single by David Justice. We go to the bottom half of inning seven with our score, 5-3 Atlanta.
Can happen when you throw strikes. His fastball is so good that anytime he gets that split finger over, he is going to handcuff some people. Tumbles down and away, catches a lot of the plate. Nothing Vanderwall could do about that. But the whole key for Mark Wohlers is his fastball and throwing it for strikes. He can do so many other things if he'll establish that he'll do that.
Two gone. Here's Walt Weiss. Weiss 0 for 3. He's grounded out to short, fly to center, and grounded out to second. When Don Baylor makes out his lineup card, there have been two positions that have been the same all season long. Weiss in the leadoff spot, Galarraga in the cleanup spot. One-oh, grounded foul off to the right. One ball, one strike. Wohlers has struck out seven in his last three in the third innings, now has 25 strikeouts in 18 innings of work this year. And has a 1-2 count on Weiss. Two and two.
One of the first pitches we've seen in a while that he dropped his elbow on and pushed that fork ball out up there, the split finger, rather than throwing it. You can see him push that split finger grip in there. It's easier for him to switch from that to a fastball than the other way around.
Into right center field, it'll fall for a base hit for Walt Weiss. Deion Sanders gets it back to the infield. Weiss aboard with a two-out single. First hit allowed by Wohlers, hit number six of the day for the Rockies. And now Mike Kingery bats for the first time. Kingery took over in center field in the top half of the seventh inning, hitting .313 for the year. No homers, three RBIs.
Spent some time with the Giants and I think with Seattle, and there was a while there it looked like he was going to be out of baseball.
Came to camp with the Rockies as a non-roster player. Started out in the Kansas City Royals organization. Last year, Kingery played at Omaha, hit .263, 10 homers, 41 RBIs. .33 years old.
Hard-working guy, always kept himself in good shape.
Looped into left field, coming over is Gallagher. And he's got it for out number three. So a good inning for Mark Wohlers. He retires the side, allowing just the base hit to Walt Weiss. We go to the eighth inning. Braves still lead it 5-3.
Let's take a look at our Delta scoreboard. The wind must be blowing out in Wrigley. Cubs leading that one 12-7. Williams and Bonds homers for San Francisco. Bouchel and Sosa homers for Chicago. All the rest of the action under the lights in the National League. There are some games being played in the American League. Here's what it looks like. Detroit by one. Kruder a home run for Detroit. Vaughn a homer for Milwaukee. 5-4 the score. New York over Baltimore. Melvin the difference in that ball game with a home run. Two-run victory for Toronto. Paul Molitor the difference. A couple of home runs. Oakland leading Chicago by one. They're early in that ball game. Later on, Boston and Minnesota. Kansas City at California, Texas at Seattle. Every weekday evening and all weekend long, turn to the Headline News Sports Ticker for all the scores.
The new pitcher for the Rockies, right-hander Steve Reed, his 20th appearance, 1-1 with one save, ERA 4.29. The league is hitting 313 off the side-arming Reed, and Javi Lopez, who's 2 for 3, leads off the eighth for Atlanta, taking a strike, nothing and one. By the way, in that Boston-Minnesota game last night, in case you missed it in the box score, with Minnesota whipping the Red Sox 21-2, two scoreless innings of relief pitched by outfielder Andy Tomberlin, a former member of the Braves organization. They brought him in the seventh and eighth innings to pitch with the game out of hand, and he shut him out for two innings.
Normally that means it's the end of the day if you're putting your jacket on and heading up the tunnel. Looks like Steve Bedrosian might be coming on for the Braves.
Still 0-2 on Lopez. Javi up to 303 for the year. Little dribbler toward third. Hayes didn't charge that ball. That's going to make it a close play at first base. Charlie Hayes stayed back on that ball, and Javi Lopez runs pretty well.
I think his instinct said catcher speed, but he didn't come up right away and unload. Watch how bang bang this is at first. Only by a half a step. If he doesn't have a good cannon, then Javi Lopez gets the infield single. Beat a couple more traveling Braves fans here. Ken and Linda Snow from Demopolis, also celebrating their 15th anniversary here in the Mile High City.
Here's Mark Lemke. Lemke 1 for 3, doubled back in the sixth inning, about a 410-foot double. Would have been out of most ballparks. Rolls this one to first. Galarraga is there, and there are two down. And now Ryan Klesko will come on to bat for Mark Wohlers. Klesko not getting the start today. Tony Tarasco did, and Tarasco drove in three of the five runs scored by the Braves. Also accounted for another one when he hit into a double play and a run scored. Klesko 0 for 5 as a pinch hitter.
Reed, one of those guys from his delivery, looks like he could really be deft on right-handers, but his ball might run back out over the plate for lefties.
He's behind in the count, 2-0.
Most of the time, right-handers who throw submarine or from the side make it difficult for right-handed hitters to stay in there.
Into foul territory, Andres Galarraga giving it a look, but it's going to make it up into the seats. And it's 2-1.
Reed's got a breaking ball, Pete, that looks like a frisbee when he throws it. He throws it from down under, and it's a sailor that just keeps coming up and in instead of down and in to a left-handed hitter. That may have been what he threw right here to Klesko. Take a look. Just like a frisbee. Yeah, right on up and in.
Here's the 2-1. Outside corner, 2-2.
Rockies has some really big pitchers, and when you throw with an awkward motion or an unusual motion like Reed, you want to come out and redesign the mound and give yourself another foot or two to play with on the right side.
Just off the inside corner, and the count full now, 3-2 to Klesko.
Good lesson right there by Reed in how not to get future close calls.
Inside corner, strike three call. Klesko complains about it to Rich Rieker. But it's a 1-2-3 inning for Steve Reed. Nothing doing for the Braves in the eighth. We go to the bottom half. Still 5-3 Atlanta. Atlanta, the new pitcher for the Braves, right-hander Steve Bedrosian, making his 13th appearance, and he's been roughed up a little of late. He has allowed 8 runs in his last 3 2/3 innings and 9 earned runs in his last 14 1/3 innings. So he's, after getting off to a great start this year, he's trying to get back into that groove. And he'll face Dante Bichette to lead off here in the eighth. Bichette, a run-scoring single, is only hit today. He's 1 for 3. Greg McMichael up again in the Atlanta bullpen. as the bottom of the eighth begins. Low ball one. Outside corner, count even, one ball, one strike. Good fastball there, one and two.
Talking to a number of people who have watched Bedrosian pitch the last few times, it said it appeared to them there was a little less velocity on his fastball, making it more important that he get the other pitches over early in the count. He's got a couple of good breaking pitches.
Now the 1-2 to Bichette. Pop foul. It stays 1-2.
See, he had put breaking ball in the mind of Dante Bichette by getting a strike early in the count. Fastball for a strike, and he ran that fastball right in on his fist.
This one's going to be out of play as well. Still a ball and two strikes on Bichette.
Got another one in on him there, Pete. Bichette looks like the kind of guy that maybe it's from his days in the American League that looks for breaking balls, two strikes, and also looks for breaking balls, 3-1, 3-2. If you make the good pitches with the fastball, you can tie him up.
This one hit deep to left center field. Forget about it. He was looking for a breaking ball there, and he got one. And that ends a string of 13 straight games without a home run for Dante Bichette. It also makes it a one-run game. His 12th homer of the year, his 32nd RBI. 5-4, Atlanta.
He had thrown two fastballs that had tied him up. Here's the breaking ball. Pretty good spot, outer half, but about belt high, and that slider speed bat, that's what they call that, nail that to left center field.
Now Andres Galarraga, who homered his last time up, he's also singled and bounced out. Here's the one strike delivery. Missing low, one ball, one strike. 5-4 Braves. Braves about hit the Rockies 12-7. The 1-1 to Galarraga outside. 2-1. Here's the 2-1 delivery, and it's fouled back, evening the count 2-2.
Galarraga starts with a wide open stance, and you think, well, gee, I can throw him something outside, but if you don't get it in that lower quadrant of the strike zone, he closes up, gets good plate coverage. Sometimes I think you're better off just running it in on his hands and taking your chances in there. Watch how he closes up now.
Full count 3-2 on Galarraga. Sharply to short, nice play, Blauser. On the first in time, one down. Well, that's one big out in a one-run game. That's a guy you always fear with one swing of the bat to tie it up. And here's another one, Charlie Hayes. Hayes 1-for-3. He had a single back in the fifth inning. Strikes to Hayes. Down goes to 2-0. These two were once traded for each other back in 1989. Giants and the Phillies hooking up in a deal. Bedrosian going to the Giants and Hayes going to the Phillies. 2-1.
Terry Mulholland also part of that.
He was in there. Dennis Cook. Tried to stop his swing, but he went. And the count even, 2-2. One out, base is empty. Braves holding on to a one-run lead. We're in the eighth. And the 2-2 pitch to Hayes, strike three call. At the knees, Hayes caught looking. Bedrosian records his first strikeout.
Just after the last strike, when he couldn't check his swing, Hayes took a long walk around. It's almost like you could see him telling himself, I am not going to get fooled on another breaking ball that I'm going to chase in the dirt. But that time, Bedrosian placed it just right to get the call.
Two men out now. Howard Johnson, a strikeout victim, is only time up back in the sixth inning.
Another guy who could hit it out of the park, Pete, and he's also had success hitting against Steve Bedrosian. 333 and a couple of them homers.
Kind of been an all or nothing season for Johnson so far. 86 at bats, 4 homers, 29 strikeouts. And he's down to the count 0-2 here. One ball, two strikes. In the air to center field. Dion is there and makes the catch for out number three. And Steve Bedrosian, after giving up the leadoff home run to Dante Bichette, gets the next three in order. And we go to the ninth inning with the Braves holding on to a one-run lead. We go to the ninth inning. Braves holding on to a one-run lead. And they'll have the top of the order to up here. Deion Sanders, Jeff Blauser, and then Dave Gallagher against Steve Reed. And looking ahead to the bottom half of the ninth inning, due up for Denver, for the Colorado Rockies, rather, here in Denver, Joe Girardi, Nelson Lariano, and then the pitcher's spot. Reed with one more warm-up toss. And don't forget tomorrow, same two clubs back here at Mile High. Greg Maddux against Lance Painter, who's just been called up from Colorado Springs, where he had a record of 4-0.
That's one of my favorite names for a player, for a pitcher. What was yours, the kid out of Florida?
Doug Million hasn't signed yet, but he will one of these days. He's a high school senior at Sarasota in Sarasota, Florida. What a great name for a ball player, Doug Million.
Perfect. Now they need a catcher named One. Million to one.
Deion 2-for-4.
Was kind of weak, wasn't it?
Yeah. Fouls the first one back out of play. Nothing and one. 5 runs, 12 hits for Atlanta. Braves have made 2 errors. Rockies 4 runs, 7 hits with 1 error. Out of play, 0-2.
Reed a little bit out of the Kent Tekulve Dan Quisenberry school of pitching. Just don't see many guys throw submarine or low sidearm.
1-2 now on Deion.
I was told once that the key to that, if you're going to do that and you see Reed do it, is you can't stand up straight and do it. Watch his head go down so that he much the same as a guy throwing over the top keeps a 90-degree angle for his elbow. The elbow, the shoulder, right at a 90-degree angle.
He had a year back in 1992. He saved 43 games in the minor leagues. He had 23 saves at Shreveport and 20 more at Phoenix.
Here's a look at what we were talking about. Watch the motion. He drops his head, and it's almost a 90-degree angle with the head, the shoulder, and the elbow.
Still 1-2 on Deion Sanders.
We were talking the other day about how Maddox, Smoltz, and Glavin have seldom, if ever, made relief appearances. Reed is the other side of that coin. He's been in baseball since 88 with only one start. They figured out early what they wanted him to do.
And he gets him. Outside corner, his second strikeout. One out in the ninth inning. That'll bring up Jeff Blauser, 1-for-2 with a couple of walks today.
A lot of movement on everything that he throws. He's had Deion Sanders foul off a couple of pitches up and away. Paints the outside corner with a backdoor breaking ball. He had been running the fastball away from him. Not much argument out of Deion Sanders.
And here's Blauser. Outside corner for a strike. Nothing and one. Trainers and club doctors will tell you this is much easier on a much easier way to throw on your arm and shoulder than throwing overhand or three quarters. That you should not really have too many difficult times with the elbow or the shoulder. It's more of a natural way to throw the ball.
I guess Kent DeColby would agree with you. He threw
that
way.
And Dan Quisenberry and Gene Garber rarely had arm problems.
DeColby was in over 1,000 ball games. Yeah, most people will tell you that anything you do lifting, throwing wise with your arm, once you raise it above shoulder level, is not natural. Kinesiologist.
Mike Marshall, the former relief pitcher, is into kinesiology. 1-2 is the count on Blauser. Outside corner, another strikeout for Reed. He's retired 5 in a row and struck out 3 in a row.
Slider away. Gallagher. Slider away, fastball in, then the frisbee ball on the outside corner.
Gallagher walked his only plate appearance. He is nailing that outside corner, 0-1.
To this point against righties, he would throw that one away, then run one in on their hands, and then go right back out there. This time it's been so successful, just stayed out there.
One ball, one strike. 5-4 Atlanta, ninth inning. Greg McMichael will come on to pitch in the bottom half of this inning. That one backed up on him, 2-1. Inside corner this time, 2-2.
Been so successful on that outside corner. I think if I were Dave Gallagher, I wouldn't be looking for something inside.
He just missed out there. Full count now, 3-2 with Fred McGriff on deck. Bruce Ruffin is up in the Rockies bullpen. If we get to McGriff, you may see Ruffin come into the game.
Strikes out the side here in the top half of the ninth.
Six in a row retired by Steve Reed. Four of them via the strikeout route. We go to the bottom half of the ninth inning. Rockies trying for their first ever win over Atlanta, and they're trailing the Braves by one.
Ninth inning, 5-4 Atlanta. Greg McMichael takes over to try to save this one for Kent Merker, who's the pitcher of record for Atlanta. McMichael making his 20th appearance and trying for his ninth save. Joe Girardi will lead off, followed by Nelson Liriano. Girardi 0 for 2 with a walk. A ball and no strikes to Girardi. Sharply hit to third. Nice play. Terry Pendleton over to first in time. And there's one big out in the bottom half of the ninth.
I think he was very pleased with that. Went to his left, kept the glove down low. That ball didn't skip on him. And the good throw makes it a good play.
Now Liriano. Roberto Mejia has moved to the on-deck circle. He'll bat for Steve Reed. Liriano 0 for 2 with a walk. Inside corner for a strike. Bedrosian working inning, allowed that home run to Bichette. That was the only hit he allowed. No walks, one strikeout. Down the left field line, foul, nothing and two. If the Braves hang on and win here, you got to give Bedrosian some credit. Even though he gave up that home run to Dante Bichette, he then settled down and got Galarraga, Hayes, and Howard Johnson, all capable of tying the game with one swing of the bat, got them in order. Here's the two-strike pitch. And that's all for Liriano. Two men gone. And now Roberto Mejia on the pinch hit.
Lopez wants it outside. It's the changeup in a good spot. Couldn't stop the swing.
Mejia, 235. He's hit four homers with 14 RBIs. He's got some power. Two men out, bases empty. Braves need one more out for a 15th consecutive win over the Rockies. And Mejia takes a strike in the outside corner. Here's the 0-1. Outside, one ball, one strike. The National League record is 20 consecutive wins over an opponent. The Major League record, 23. Baltimore in 69 and 70 beat the Kansas City Royals 23 straight times. Here's the 1-1. 1-2. And a lot of similarities if you look at the Braves against the Rockies and then go back in that Baltimore-Kansas City in 69 and 70. The Orioles had great pitching with Dave McNally and people like that. Jim Palmer. Kansas City was an expansion team in its first 2 years in 69 and 70. And here's the Braves with this pitching staff against the Colorado.